ओके गाइस, वेयर वी स्टॉप यस्टरडे।
फॉरगेट सर।
या तो प्रोग्रामिंग लेवल वर्चुअलाइजेशन दैट आल्सो वी फिनिश्ड, वॉइस लेवल वर्चुअलाइजेशन वी आल्सो दैट आल्सो फिनिश्ड। सो सिन वॉइस लेवल वर्चुअलाइजेशन व्हाट हैपेंस, say if you are running a number of applications, it will create a number of separate execution environments for each of the application. So if you are running, say for example, three applications, it will create three parallel and separate execution environments for three applications, and there you need not have any hypervisor or something like that. Okay, that is OS level virtualization. And in programming level virtualization, that can be achieved by using suitable virtual environments like .NET, CLI, that is common language. What is that? CLR, common language runtime, and common language infrastructure. And for Java, it is Java virtual machine. So that is, you write program in one language, so then you compile it and you get a bytecode, and you take that bytecode in and execute in any other platform, let it be Linux or Macintosh or anywhere. So by default, JVM will be there. It will take care of its execution. So that means it supports virtualization at programming level. Okay. So therefore, very few languages supports for virtualization at programming level, including .NET and Java. And programming level virtualization is also called as process level virtualization. Okay, that we saw. Then application level virtualization. Okay, this also. So this also we finished. So application level virtualization means, say for example, when you are running an application and it may require a number of resources. If any of the resources are not satisfied by the host machine, then you can depend on cloud platform for that. Okay, that means you will be consuming through cloud. So if that is the thing, we can call it as application level virtualization. Okay, so even though you have an application, you don't have sufficient resources so that you can efficiently run your application. So for that support, you depend on cloud. That is nothing but application level virtualization. So and the resources which you can depend on cloud includes partial file system, libraries, operating system. What is that? Operating system, component emulation, and so on. And in this, applications are not installed in the expected runtime environment. So that means, say for example, see the application is installed in virtual server, and you are running using your host machine. That is also possible. Or application is installed in your host machine, and you are depending upon cloud for certain resources. That is also possible. So in either way, so you'll be de so there exists a dependency on both the host machine as well as a cloud. So and the strategies for implementing application level virtualization, there are two techniques: interpretation. So in this, every source instruction is interpreted by an emulator for executing native instruction set, ISA instructions. So that means, so when you go for interpretation, each and every instruction that executes in the virtual machine will be interpreted by the hypervisor. So that is by using the native ISA instructions. So there happens the emulation. That means, emulation means, say the underlying architecture may be different, and the guest OS what you have installed on the VM may be different. So if it requires any conversions, that will be taken care by hypervisor. And the binary translation, so in this, every source instruction is converted into the native instructions. The meaning of the native instruction is, so the format in which your the host hardware will understand. So in your host machine, you will be having the hardware. Okay, so it can understand certain format. That format is nothing but the native format. So if your application running on the VM requires any conversion, so that conversion is called as binary conversion. If it executes directly by using the hardware, so then okay, it doesn't require any conversion. In case if something is converting into another format, we call it as binary translation. And during this conversion, it may have to, the hypervisor may have to execute some functions. So using the functions, it will convert instructions into native format. And block of instructions are translated, cached, and reused. That means, say for example, you are accessing certain feature repeatedly again and again. If that is the case, it need not convert each and every time the same instruction into the native format. So that means binary translation is not required every time. So instead, once it can converts, it can save all the recently used instructions in the cache memory, and it can reuse. So and it's a it incurs large overhead cost in terms of conversion, but as you can reuse the same functionality again and again, so that means you are reusing the instructions that have already translated into binary format. Okay, so in that sense, so if you are using it for a long time, so it gives you better performance. Then types, storage virtualization. I think from here we need to start. Storage virtualization. So it allows decoupling the physical organization of the hardware from its logical representation using network-based virtualization known as storage area network. That means, say for example, you're using your laptop or a computer or a desktop. Okay, it will decouple the actual storage and your system. So just like how you deal with the Google Drive. So when you are dealing with the Google Drive, you have two options. One is, so directly go to the Google Drive web. Okay, you store it there. So that is one model. And the second model is you install the desktop portion of the Google Drive into your laptop or into the desktop system. There you go and drop your content. Okay, that is one model. But even though if you drop that content into that desktop application, actually when you connect your system to the internet, so it will sync with the cloud database. Okay, so in the cloud there will be your Google Drive account associated with your Gmail account. There it will sync. Okay, so that's the concept of storage virtualization. Even the Microsoft provides with SkyDrive. Okay, so those are all examples for storage virtualization. Even for the Google Meet, what happens, see now after the session, so now I am recording the session, so it will, since I am recording the Google Meet session, it will record, and in my Google Drive account, it will create a folder, and inside that it will store a video, and after upon storing the video, it will send one email link to my email, so that I can go to Google Drive and I can download the video. That means where it is storing, virtually it is storing somewhere else in the cloud. Okay, that is the example for storage area network. So that is storage virtualization. Okay, so that means we can access, we can retrieve the data, we can modify the data, we can push the data, but not in our own host system. So that will be pushed to the cloud using suitable interfaces like Google Drive and so on. And network virtualization. It combines hardware, appliances, and specific software for the creation and management of virtual network. So that means it requires both hardware support and software support to virtualize any network resources. Say for example, so even though you are accessing Google Drive sitting at your home, you feel as if you are there in the cloud data center, and from there only you are accessing it, isn't it? So that means by sitting, you have seamless access to the data. So for that you are making use of the network, that is nothing but the internet. So using the internet, you are connecting to the cloud and you are accessing the resources. So that is called network virtualization. So it can aggregate different physical networks into a single logical network. So the meaning of aggregating different physical network, in the sense connecting multiple networks to become one single unit and giving the image as if the entire thing resembles as one single network, one single logical network. Say for example, you are combining, let us assume, two clusters and one grid network. So that means the total number of individual networks are three in number, but it will give you a feeling that you are accessing one single logical network. Okay, that's also another example of network virtualization. Okay, so that means it will create an illusion of single image. Okay, you are dealing with one single logical network. Okay, then desktop virtualization. Okay, there is desktop virtualization already. Actually, we know that, we have discussed, but we didn't label it as desktop virtualization. So the look at this diagram. Just if you look at this diagram, you'll come to know what is the meaning of desktop virtualization. So look at this diagram. So you have the hardware in the lowermost layer, and so they're taking the example of hypervisor, type 1 hypervisor. So type 1 hypervisor means which you can directly install upon the bare hardware, which is also called as bare metal model or bare metal hypervisor, bare metal virtualization. Upon that, you can see we have installed a number of guest operating systems. So one can be Macintosh, one can be Ubuntu, one can be Windows 8, one can be Windows 10 or something like that. So depending upon what kind of applications you want to run and what is the required ideally suited operating system for that. So like that, you can decide how many guest operating systems you want. Okay. So, and that is dependent on your hardware capacity. So there is no restriction that, so you can have only these many number of guest operating system. So depending upon your RAM capacity and your storage capacity, so you can decide so how many guest operating systems you can have and how many applications you are running. So the moment when the performance of the overall system starts degrading, then you can stop installing new applications or new guest operating systems. A desktop system with multiple operating systems. So desktop virtualization means, so using one desktop machine, if you can have multiple guest operating, multiple operating systems, so you can call it as desktop virtualization. So to achieve that, you can use type 1 hypervisor. So where you need not have any host operating system. So example, Mac OS and Windows at the same time can form parallel desktop. Okay. So hypervisor type 1 similar to server virtualization. So that means this concept is telling that this concept is similar to server virtualization. See there what happens in case of a server, we will be having one server, but we will be installing, so and we will have one server and it will be having one host operating system. So upon that, we keep hosting a number of applications, because most of the time servers are dedicated machines. So when I say dedicated machine, we install more applications. So and sometimes another scenario is also possible, where we convert our normal desktop machine into a server. Okay, at that time we don't install too many applications because it is not a dedicated server. Then then we need to understand when we need to go for desktop virtualization and why it is useful. Say for example, you have built an application, say for example you have built one web application or one mobile application. So then you want to check how it will behave in Windows, how it will behave in Linux, are there any restrictions during execution before releasing the software. So the best thing that you can do is to test that software. You can install multiple guest operating systems and you can install the same application on each of the guest operating system. And now since you have different guest operating system, each application is isolated. Okay, that means It will not interfere with any other guest operating system, so that you can easily test. So once you can test with Windows 8, then Windows 10, then you can test with Ubuntu. Okay, so like that you can test the same software using multiple operating systems. So that is where you can use desktop virtualization. And at the same time, sometimes especially the cloud admins, okay, you see usually what they do, to push the data or to do some of the operations, they depend up. So to interact with GUI, they depend upon Windows based machines. But when it comes to core maintenance and hosting the applications, they will always rely on Linux based operating systems. So that means, so they you by using the same system, they should interact with both Windows and the Linux based machines. So if that is the scenario, they can have so Windows one Windows guest operating system and one Linux guest operating system. And it is useful for testing software on multiple operating systems. That's what I told. And it reduces hardware cost. So why? Because see, usually how the traditional system used to work. So the traditional system used to work just like, so usually in the olden days, we used to have only one operating system per machine. So after that, so we started installing multiple operating systems into one machine. So where there when there was no virtualization, what we used to do? Say for example, first we used to install Windows. After that, so we used to create a partition for Linux, and we used to install Linux also as a separate full-fledged operating system. So we used to install 2-3 operating systems. Now after the emergence of virtualization, especially after 2000, so we slowly started using virtualization. So as a result, using virtualization, we create virtual machines. Upon that, we install multiple guest operating systems. Okay, now the diagram, what you are seeing, that is also called as local desktop virtualization. Okay, next, application server virtualization. Okay, so look at the definition. Application server virtualization abstracts a collection of application servers that provide the same service as a single virtual application server. That means, so usually in the data center, they do consolidation of server application servers and web servers. Say for example, they can bring together some 5 to 10 application servers, and they can interconnect, and they can install a layer of load balancer. Okay, it will monitor, say for example, it will start. So whenever the user tries to host application to the remote server, so it will start with server one. Okay, when the capacity of the server one exceeds, the load balancer will give the signal so that the next application will go to the server two. Like that, it will fill all the servers. Okay, and okay, so that is called server virtualization, bringing together all the application servers and creating the image as if so it is one single logical unit. Okay, see, even after interconnecting multiple application servers, okay, the purpose is same. Okay, and the behavior also remains the same, and providing better quality of service rather than emulating a different environment. So the overall idea of bringing together multiple application servers or web servers together is to provide better quality of service. So that means, so how we can provide better quality of service? So that means, instead of putting too many applications into a single server, dedicated server machine, if you bring together multiple dedicated servers, and if you have a load balancer, so that you can put optimum load to each server and you can extract better performance. So that is the idea. Next is virtualization and cloud computing. Okay, so look at this statement, virtualization and cloud computing. Say if there is no virtualization, there is no cloud computing. Why? Because in cloud means we use virtual resources. Okay, so hence without virtualization, there is no cloud. Virtualization plays an important role in cloud computing, and in one of our earlier classes also we have told that. So one of the basic concepts of cloud computing is virtualization, and virtualization technologies are primarily used to offer configurable computing environments and storage. Okay, so the meaning of configurable computing environments means, say actually sometimes some in case of some of the services the user can configure, so how many resources you want, how many instances you want. Okay, so that is also possible. And for other things, so just you can consume on runtime, so dynamically it will be configured during runtime at the data center. Both are possible. Okay, there are certain things which the user can configure. Okay, and there are certain things which will be configured during runtime dynamically. Both are possible. And for that purpose only we have a consumption model, that is pay for how much you consume. So if you are going for that model, obviously, so then the cloud setup will be very much scalable and flexible for you. So just you keep consuming the resources. So yeah, okay, so it will only configure how many instances you want, everything. So ultimately you need to pay for how much you consume. Then hardware virtualization is an enabling factor for solutions in infrastructure as a service market segment. Okay, so that means hardware virtualization is an enabling factor for solutions in IaaS. That means you need to understand the hardware virtualization is an application of infrastructure as a service. And programming level virtualization is an application of platform as a service. So why? Because when you say platform as a service, so it provides you an environment wherein you can start writing the application. So once you are done with writing the program or an software, then you can compile the program, you can run, and also there is a facility wherein you can deploy the application as well. That is platform as a service. So when we say platform as a service, the cloud should provide you the facility to develop, compile, run, and deploy the application. Okay, so everything is virtual environment. That is platform as a service. For example, Google App Engine provides that facility wherein you can, by using the Google programming, Google APIs, you can create everything. You can create, you can write the programs, you can compile there only, and you can deploy in Google servers. Okay, and it will use Google file system. Okay, so everything is virtual complete. It will provide complete set of services, but at the same time also there will be some restrictions. Say for example, so whatever the language they suggest, you are bound to use only that one, and whatever the APIs they have, you are bound to use only those things. So that means there are limitations and also advantages as well when you go for platform as a service. So look at this example. So this is an diagram of server consolidation and virtual machine migration. Okay, so server consolidation means, first of all, we should know, so bringing together multiple servers. So here they have assumed a cloud setup with two servers. Okay, so look at the upper portion of the diagram. So initially, see, there is an user, okay, who is connected to some virtual machine. Okay, so which is installed in server B. So, and at the same time in that data center also there is one more server, server A, and it contains so many virtual machines, and this guy is accessing some application which is installed in this VM. Okay, so now see here, the migration means, so as I told, the application installed in one VM can be migrated easily to another VM. That is also possible. And at the same time, you can migrate the complete VM itself from one server to another server. See, virtual machine is simply an ISO file. So, okay, you can copy it from one machine and you can paste it in another machine. So it's an ISO file. So that means you can migrate easily one VM from another, from one server to another server. So look at here. So now here we have two virtual machines. So that this diagram shows the setup before migration, before migrating the virtual machines from one server to another server. Now look at here after migration. So initially, before migration, the server A, it was hosting 3+1, 4 virtual machines, and server B was hosting 2 virtual machines. Now here after hosting, the server A is having 6 virtual machines and server B is having nothing. That means, so whatever the virtual machines server B was having are shifted to server A. So now through this diagram, we can demonstrate server consolidation. That means using one server, okay, so bringing together multiple, creating multiple virtual machines, and at the same time within one data center we have multiple servers. So and see here, so upon both the server machines we have installed a layer of middleware called as hypervisor. Okay, so this hypervisor is installed upon both the, that means by using the hypervisor we are connecting server A and server B, but we are shifting all the virtual machines of server B to server A. Okay, so therefore this diagram serves for two purposes. One is server consolidation and virtual machine migration. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, anything you want to ask in this diagram?
No, sir.
Okay. So through this diagram, the takeaway from this diagram is that, so even the virtual machine monitor or the hypervisor not only can be installed on the desktops or on the laptops, it can also be installed on the server machines as well. Okay, so look at here, it is installed on both server A and B. Okay, then only we can consolidate both the servers. At the same time, the virtual machines can be completely migrated from one server machine to another server machine. Okay, that is one scenario. See, migration means there are two points. One is migrating only the application, and another thing is migrating the complete virtual machine. Okay, so when you migrate only one application, that means exactly you are migrating one application to another, from one VM to another VM. But when you say migrating a complete VM, so that VM may contain n number of applications. So that means you are moving everything as a single package. Okay, that's the greatest advantage of migrating a virtual machine. Okay, advantages of virtualization. So reduced spending. So why? Because by using a single machine, we are creating multiple virtual machines and installing multiple guest operating systems and so on. So we are ready. We are saving a lot of cost instead of buying a separate machine to have a separate operating system. Okay. So in that sense, reducing the spending, and it follows sandbox approach. Okay, sandbox approach means, so you need not worry about how you achieve virtualization. Just you install suitable virtual machine so that it will take care of how to virtualize and all. Okay, you need not worry about that. So that is called sandbox. And portability. So portability means, as I told, so you can migrate easily the applications as well as virtual machines from one machine to another machine. Okay, it supports for portability. Then efficient use of resources. Okay, since you can use you can install multiple virtual machines, obviously the resources will be utilized to the maximum extent. Then easier backup and disaster recovery. Okay, so easier backup and disaster recovery. So especially when you are connected to the cloud setup. Okay, so you need not worry about your data, whether it will be saved forever or not, whether you can take a backup or not. Okay, that will be taken care by the cloud setup. Okay, they will have suitable mechanisms wherein they can recover the data. Okay, then better business continuity. So if you are having MOU with any of the cloud service provider, okay, since the cloud platform itself is flexible and scalable, so it provides better business continuity and more efficient IT operations. Okay, and you can execute your IT operations more efficiently. So as everything will be maintained by the third party. Okay, you need not worry about its maintenance and other things. And disadvantages, upfront costs. Okay, so that means while buying the hypervisor, obviously you need to pay for it. Okay, in academics, usually we use VMware kind of things. So those are the basic things that will not suit for the industry setup. Okay, they are not robust, whatever we use in the academics. So obviously they have to deal with licensing and so many other things. So that means cost is involved and they have to purchase the license. Okay, and possible learning curve. Okay, so okay, when they go for professional hypervisors, so they need to learn it first how to use, so then only they can deal with it. Then performance degradation. See, this is very important. Okay, so the meaning of performance degradation is here. Say, especially when you want to do simulation, okay, full-fledged operating systems are ideally suited. Why? Because so usually while creating the virtual machines, so it will, so it is bound to use only a restricted amount of resources. So therefore, those many resources may not be sufficient for an simulation program. So if that is the case, even your system may crash, your VM may crash. Okay, so in that sense, always the full-fledged operating systems will yield better. That means that traditional operating system will yield better performance than the virtual machines. Okay, and inefficiency and degraded user experience. So see, this happens usually when you install too many applications. Say, for example, you are having basic hardware setup, but upon that you are installing virtual machines and creating or installing too many applications. So since you have one virtual machine but installing too many applications with basic hardware setup, obviously you feel the system you feel like system response is very slow and the performance will be degraded. So security holes and threats. Since cloud computing uses internet, so internet means always there is a security issue and always there are chances of new threats. Okay, that's about pros and cons. So I think we can stop it here. So after 7-8 minutes, you have another class. Okay, we'll stop it here. Thank you. That's all for the day.
Thank you, sir.